Hey, welcome back to the Personality Hacker Podcast. My name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge. And we don't do a lot of pre or early podcast banter as a rule.
Yeah.
But I just have to say,
we should get right to it usually.
Yeah. It's a million degrees in this podcasting room. So I want to warn you, the listener, that if I pass out or die of heat exhaustion and or spontaneously combust, we can just put like the Monty Python intro music over the sounds of my mortality, and then you'll just have to keep rolling.
So at the time of this recording, it's summertime.
Yeah.
It's probably like in the 90s Fahrenheit outside.
Oh.
And what's crazy, I just read this recently, what these sound panels do in a room like this is they transfer sound energy into heat. That's how they dampen the sound.
Yeah.
So the more we talk, we're already probably full of a lot of hot air.
Mm-hmm.
We're creating even more heat in here with our voices.
Yeah. Yeah, this could be like an alternative energy source.
Yeah, like a nuclear reactor for the house.
For the world, really. We should be harnessing this.
Yeah.
But maybe not, because we might be dead by the end of the podcast, so I don't know. We might not have anything left to give. I feel like if you squeezed me right now, I would just be juice. Just be like juice coming from all of my pores.
I just took my shirt off. That's how I handled this.
I know.
It's so hot, but.
I'm not suggesting
you do this. I'm just saying that that's what I did to solve the problem for me, and I am definitely still warm.
And it's an audio podcast, so I guess I could be stripping during the entire podcast as well, but I don't know. I just feel like that would send the wrong message.
Behind the scenes, what they can't show you on the air.
Yeah. So my apologies for the early podcast banter. It's not going to become a rule, I promise. I'm just. Like sweat is dripping off of my face. And I'm hoping that I have the energy to be able to like, I'll give it my all.
Yeah.
But I might be like a puddle by the end.
So your heat situation notwithstanding, we're going to just move on and hope for the best here.
I think it's a good idea.
So today I want to start off the podcast by talking about how our children, watch a lot of YouTube videos. And if you have kids, you're listening, you got kids, I'm sure your kids probably have discovered this idea of YouTube, watching YouTube videos. And the thing I've noticed, I think I've talked about this in a podcast before, of how many YouTube videos that my kids watch that are about other people doing things. So they're watching people skateboarding down like alpine hills in France, and they're watching people dig and build these like structures in the jungle, and they're watching people do, like our daughter watches people do makeup, and like they're watching people live lives and do things and create and be creative and hook things up. And I keep going, and they'll also watch video game, like tons of video game play. And I keep thinking this is the weirdest thing, because when I was a kid, I wanted to go do all these things, not watch somebody do all these things. But we were talking about this right before we came on the air. We live basically in a pornography culture. Like, I mean, not just actual pornography, which is something that is very available online for people, but you know, all of us are kind of like, when I say pornography, I don't mean literal pornography, but I mean we're watching other people do things instead of doing them ourselves.
Yeah, we're voyeurs.
Yeah, a voyeur culture. Maybe that's a better way to say it. And I think that's really interesting to see how many people live vicariously by watching other people do actual activities. And the reason why this conversation is relevant and why we started off the podcast talking about this is today we're talking about the cognitive function of extroverted sensing. So SE or sensation, what we've nicknamed it here at Personality Hacker, this is the cognitive function of all SPs in the Myers-Briggs system. ESFPs, ISFPs, ESTPs, and ISTPs use this as their learning or information gathering or perceiving cognitive function. This is how they enter the world with this extroverted sensing function. And extroverted sensing is very much about the real time, in the moment. You're observing things with your senses almost just instantly, and you're in the experience very often. And what's interesting about my kids watching so many YouTube videos is they're usually watching things that are experiences in the moment, but outside of themselves, at a distance, vicariously, voyeuristically.
Yeah, they get to keep homeostasis while they can simulate doing something that would take them out of homeostasis.
Yeah. And so as we talk about, we're advocating for all these different functions. And today we're advocating of why the world needs extroverted sensing. And it's our instinct that we're going to have a culture that just passively watches other people do stuff unless we find a way to connect ourselves back to the real experiences in the moment, the actual gritty, visceral experiences that extroverted sensing can bring us.
Yeah, that's the whole concept in Pixar's WALL-E, is that we turn into this consumeristic, passive, voyeuristic culture where, I mean, the cartoon characters or the, excuse me, the animated characters by the end of the movie almost didn't look like they'd have bones left. They were just sort of blobs of humanity. And with a big gulp and in a lazy boy that did all the movement for them. And then
with a screen in their face, right?
With a screen in their face. And then robotic AI did everything around them. The robotic AI lived life. Everybody else just passively experienced whatever, you know, whatever they're experiencing. And I think that's one of the reasons why I love sensation or extroverted sensing so much, is that when it's being done well. Now, of course, as we've been advocating for each of these cognitive functions, assume we're talking about healthy versions of this, because nobody really needs an unhealthy experience of anything. Like, we do have that, but we don't really need it. And the world is not looking for more unhealthy expressions of things. So assume we're talking about the healthy expressions, because the unhealthy expressions of each of these functions can go way off the rails. When extroverted sensing or sensation is healthy, it can't passively experience life. It must be in the middle of it. It is real-time kinetic. It's present. It has to feel itself as an instrument in the body. It has to read other cues from other instruments and bodies. It has to create an extension of its body with tools and instruments. So sensation can't sit around. It can't be passive. Not really. Not if it's fully, you know, fully showing up. And so what sensation reminds the world, and what we desperately need reminders around, is that we cannot be voyeurs for life. Not if we want to be a sustainable species. Like, that has a law of diminishing returns really quick. And if sensation can remind us, not simply by watching a video of somebody else doing this extraordinary or interesting thing, or watch somebody else live life, right, while we allow our lives to take a back seat, if we can be reminded of the importance of this, then we won't end up in a dystopic future of passively being entertained until something smarter comes along and takes over our position at the top of the food. Well, we're really out of the food chain, but as apex, you know, species on the planet.
You know, one thing when you talked about, you know, watching others do stuff, I want to be clear that we don't say that that's necessarily a bad thing. One of the things that extroverted sensing does is give us a vision for what's possible, like what the human body is capable of. Like some of these videos, my son Sawyer was showing me a video the other day of this guy on a skateboard in the Alps in France, riding down a hill, getting up to 70 miles per hour on a skateboard. They were filming him do this and he didn't crash. And he was like, cars are whizzing past him and he's like flying down this mountain pass. And I'm going, That's an incredible insight into what the human body, what we are as humans are capable of. Because I never would have assumed that that could be done. And this person did it. And I was like, wow. I even shared it with our profiler training students. Like, look at this extroverted sensing example right now. This is incredible. Like, it almost makes me nervous to watch him. Because at any moment, hits a little speck of dust on the road and he's going to flip and probably die. Like, he's got a helmet and some pads on, but that's it. Going at extremely high speeds. So I think it gives us an insight. That's what extroverted sensing can often do with the voice. Like, the voyeuristic isn't bad in and of itself. It's good to get a glimpse of that. We watch Olympic athletes to find out what human potential is. We watch, you know, all these people doing creative endeavors, maybe dancers or performers. Wow, that's incredible what somebody can do with their voice or their body or their dance or their movements. It inspires us, quite frankly. And I think that's really a great benefit for extroverted sensing, the inspiration piece.
And the entertainment piece. Like, extroverted sensing or sensation can be incredibly entertaining. And I think that being entertained is a positive thing. Like, I mean, it does sound like we're talking crap about just passively watching things, but obviously we're talking about a balance. I'm passively entertained by things all the time, and I don't feel like that's necessarily undermining my ability to get things done in the world. But we are getting to a point, I think, culturally, at least in first, you know, when we have first world problems, one of the challenges with a first world problem is that, you know, now Netflix set the tone of streaming an entire season at the same time. And so now we do binge watching of TV shows, and we might spend entire days not leaving the house, just binge watching a series. And so, I mean, there's nothing like ethically wrong with that. And also, we can be very seduced into doing nothing. We can be very seduced into passively experiencing life through, you know, through other people's examples, like you mentioned on YouTube or in, you know, TV shows, people whose lives are invented by storytellers. Sensation reminds us that we have to get up and go. We have to take action. We can't just sit there. We have to actually be doing something. We've talked a little bit about this before, but extroverted sensing, when it's hooked up to an EEG machine and it's being used in the brain, regardless of what personality type is using it, but this is most manifest in SPs, there's a phenomenon that happens inside their mind called Dario Nardi called it the tennis hop. And that basically means that their brain, just kind of like a tennis player, if you notice when they're prepping themselves in a match, they will hop back and forth between their left and their right foots, kind of swaying back and, or feet, foots, feet. They're swaying back and forth in order to already be in a momentum toward wherever the ball is coming. So if the ball comes to the left, it will only take one moment for them to be swaying left to go chase the ball. It's called tennis hop. And the sensation or extroverted sensing mind is almost in a perpetual tennis hop. It's always ready for something next. Now, that doesn't mean that a person, particularly an SP, is always going to be actively using extroverted sensing or sensation. They might be using other elements of their brain, so that doesn't mean that their brains are constantly doing that. But when they're using that function, that's what's happening for them. So the stronger that function is for a person in their CAR model or their cognitive function stack, the more they're going to be restless if the world doesn't give them a tennis ball. Like if nothing comes at them, if there's nothing going on, if there's no engagement, that you can imagine how exhausting and frustrating it would be to constantly be ready for something that never happens. So when the world throws something at people who use this function, the people who use this function are ready to respond. That's why they're so good at being, you know, first. We've talked about this a million times. They're good at being first responders. They're good at being athletes. They're good at being performers, etc. But I think that that concept of being ready for anything is a really good reminder, because that's one of the challenges we face in the modern world, is that we are not, you know, that concept that luck favors the prepared. Most of us are not prepared. Most of us don't build skill to be prepared for anything. We're not anticipating the world throwing something at us. We're expecting things to kind of be sort of what it's always been. Now, of course, we'll have like these phrases that the world is, you know, oh, the world is getting worse. And, you know, like, or somebody will say, I mean, it's all over the gamut. The world is either getting worse or it's getting better or whatever the story is. But regardless is that we think we on a like a philosophical level that we've got it kind of figured out. But we don't really expect our lives to change from one day to the next, not substantially. So we don't really, we're not really a prepared species anymore. There was a time period where we were very physically prepared, because if we weren't physically prepared, it meant our death. We're at a time right now where the entire world accommodates us literally sitting down and watching a flickering light on a small screen for two whole days. Like, we can do that. We can.
And not starve to death or get killed.
That's right. We can just pause every once in a while and go and relieve ourselves in a bathroom that has running water. And if we don't want to engage with a human being or cook our own food, we can take our phone and use Uber Eats as an app, and somebody will come deliver food for us. And we don't have to prepare it, cook it, find it, like nothing. Like somebody just came and got us food. Food to our taste. Like the thing that we wanted to taste, the specific food that we had a taste for, we just put in an app and somebody comes and delivers it for us. And that's it. That's all we had to do. And it's over. So that's an amazing system. Those are amazing systems that we've built for ourselves. And we credit, in another podcast, we've already talked about how extroverted thinking is awesome, right? And why the world needs extroverted thinking for all these systems. And these systems are amazing, extraordinary. And they've let us be so lazy. Like, we've gotten so lazy.
Or passive. You could say it passive too. I think some people go the lazy route, but some people are just more, they're not lazy inherently. They're just passive, right?
I'm not saying that people are lazy. I'm saying that the systems around us allow us to be lazy.
Fair enough.
Yeah. And so because we've allowed ourselves to be lazy, that message of maybe we should prepare ourselves despite that. Maybe we should get into action despite that. Maybe we should be, if opportunity does come, maybe we should be observant, which is another thing that sensation teaches us to be. Teaches us to be observant, teaches us to be in the moment, teaches us to look for opportunity, and it teaches us to be prepared when opportunity comes. And when all of those things coalesce into a single moment, sensation is probably one of the best, like if it's being done well, it's probably one of the best at seeing and taking advantage of those moments. So And this is probably one of the reasons why people marvel at types like ENTJs who are coupling extroverted thinking or effectiveness with extroverted sensing or sensation. That's one of the reasons why people like that are so good at being opportunistic. It's because they're coupling systems thinking with an awareness and a readiness.
In the present moment.
In the present moment, exactly. So those are all really important lessons for us. Like, those are messages that we need to be hearing. And unfortunately, what we end up doing with the extroverted sensing or sensation function is we end up simply being entertained by it. We don't see it as a message. We don't necessarily take it to heart that it's modeling something that all of us could be doing better. We are just entertained by it, and we let it give us a reason to sit back and not do something. Because it's like, oh, I guess that has that handled for us. I'm just going to watch somebody else evidence 10,000 hours of acumen in front of me with their extraordinary ability to perform or whatever. And I'm just going to be like, wow, that was amazing. While I'm still sitting on the couch with my Uber Eats, right? My food that was delivered to me. And then kind of grumble the next day when I have to go to work.
I think you're spot on about kind of how it shows up to give us this present moment viewpoint. And I think I would add to that to say it also helps us get into our physical body in the present moment. Like, there's so much, and I say this as a person who has a sensing function, and my personality is my last fourth function, right? It's my introverted sensing, so it's not extroverted sensing, but it's still my sensing function. Sometimes it's really hard for me to be aware of, like, my bodily needs. It's, like, hard to know, oh, I'm hangry right now. That's why I'm frustrated. I need to go stop and eat something. Oh, I need exercise. Oh, I need sleep. Like, I'm just not as aware of that. But I know that I grew up in a household. My dad and my brother are both SFPs. And my mom's an INFJ, so everybody's, you know, got extroverted sensing somewhere in their cognitive function stack car model. And it really helped me, I think, get more in tune with my body and what my body needs were, because I watched the other people around me attuned to those things. Now, sometimes I think extroverted sensing could just marginalize the body because it's so present in it. And that's some of the message I also got from my dad was always like, well, don't meet your needs. Just let's keep moving. Let's keep going. Cause he's SC, just boom, boom, boom. Let's go, 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 go. So maybe he wasn't as aware. Of course, it's a secondary function as a ISFP, but I would say that there is a sense of this. Like, my brother's into bodybuilding as an ESFP. He has definitely helped me get more healthy and more strength training and things like that in my life at certain times that I've engaged with him on that. But it's a very present to the body moment. You feel like you have a sense of yourself, your physicality. And I think extroverted sensing or sensation can really give us a sense of that and help us point the way to helping our bodies become better, seeing what their limitations are. So it's not just the inspiration, what humans at their Olympic athlete potential can do, but also on a more small, like, local level, like what I can do with my body and what I should be doing with my body. And seeing a lot of extroverted sensing sensation people taking care of their bodies, eating healthy, disciplining their bodies, going to the gym, becoming athletes, going through all that, it's like inspiration to me. And these aren't even like Olympic athletes. These are just normal people, right? Just everyday people attuning and taking care of themselves. And it makes me go, you know what? I want to take a cue from that. That's really interesting what they're doing. I want to also take that and make that part of my experience.
Yeah, I don't think that there should ever be a time for body shaming, but there is a place for reminding us that we don't have to go down a road of being unhealthy.
Body inspiration. Body, rather than body shaming.
There you go. Body inspiration. I think that that's a fantastic way of looking at it. And yeah, like the fact that your brother, I mean, he's just prioritized taking care of his body. And that's something that he's naturally interested in. And because of that, I've been around him for almost a decade now. And every time I'm around him, I'm like, yep, I need to hit the gym. And what's great is that in part, like right now, I've been trying to really take care of my body for like the last few months. I've turned it into a priority because, you know, I'm 41, it's not gonna get any better, right? Like if I'm waiting for a time when my body's like, oh, I'm just gonna naturally burn fat faster, just out of nowhere, that ship has sailed and I should probably get to step in, right? And so I had that awareness, that come to Jesus moment, and started taking care of my body better. I cut out all dairy, which has been a game changer. And I also have been doing yoga and working out every day. So I'll do like 2 days of resistance training and running, and then I'll do the third day of yoga. And I haven't ever felt this good. Like even in the past when I was younger, I worked out all the time. I've been working out since I was 18 and I've been going to the gym all throughout my 20s, but I ate like crap because I didn't understand. I didn't understand the relationship of like food with health. I just thought you had to work out. And because I was young enough, my body wasn't showing, it wasn't showing the calories I was actually consuming and the low quality food I was eating because I was working out. But now that I'm 41, it's got to be a one-two punch, right? And so a lot of what I'm doing, though, is modeling him. Like, he's been around me for, what, we got married in 2012, but we've known each other since 2010. So he's basically been my brother-in-law for almost 7 years. And he, like, a lot of what I do is based on conversations I've had with him and familiarizing myself with him, like, with what he's doing. He's gone and worked out with me a couple times and shown me some, you know, some exercises that I never even knew existed. And so I now incorporate them into, you know, and when I go to the gym. And so it's like just having his energy around, just having him around has been massively inspiring to me, even though I don't eat like he does, because of course he's a bodybuilder. So he's eating like ridiculous amounts of chicken, you know, every day, to a point where he said that he almost gags when he eats chicken. Like, that's how much chicken he eats.
He's like 6,000 calories a day or something. It's ridiculous amounts.
It's insane. And he's enormous, and you can tell, right? And he does both deadlifting and bodybuilding competition. So not only is he strong, but he's also sculpted. And he wins all the time and stuff. And it's like just having his energy around me, I don't want to say that sometimes I've been ashamed around him, but I have had these moments when I'm like, he's prioritizing something I should be prioritizing. Why am I not doing it? And I'm sure he's been a node in the system that finally kicked my butt into gear to go, yeah, I need to go do this. So it's those kinds of things that Sensation models. And it does it for its own, like, it's not necessarily doing it for anybody else. I know, like, he and I have talked a little bit about, he says that he might have an Adonis complex. And so he works out so that he can look good as well. But I think if that component was completely removed, I don't think he would spend any minutes less in the gym. He's really doing it because it makes him feel amazing. And so there is that component to Sensation or extroverted sensing where they do understand how people perceive them, or at least that's top of mind. And at the same time, he's gotten to a point where he loves it so much that he's not going to stop. And I think that's been personally inspiring to me for sure.
It's interesting that you have a very, like, when you're around him, it's a very immediate experience. And I think that's the other thing that extroverted sensing really gives us, is a sense of the now and it uncomplicates what's happening. And it says, look, what do you see? Like, the medium is the message. Like, what are you looking at right now? Like, stop overthinking this. Stop analyzing things to death. Stop abstracting everything, which there's value in all of those. Obviously, as an intuitive user, as an intuitive primary, obviously there's tons of value in those things, I would think. And there's this ability for extroverted sensing to just cut out the future, cut out the past, cut out the abstract, cut out all the narrative and the clutter around what's happening and go, what is happening right now? Like, that is the message. Like, that's the thing that's going on right now. This person's behaving this way. That's what's happening. Like, that's the real thing happening. Like, stop getting all the narratives and stories on it. This is the real right now in the moment. And I really appreciate that about extroverted sensing. I think it helps me focus in on things that are going on currently, and it gets me into the present moment. It's a very powerful process for that, to get zoomed in on the here and now and what's going on. And this is something that I think we can all learn from extroverted sensing, is sometimes it's not about the meaning. Sometimes it's just not. Sometimes it's not about all the logic and all the future pacing and the stories of my past and all these. Maybe it's just about what's going on, and I can just be here now in that experience. That's powerful to have that available to us as humans.
Yeah, because I think particularly as intuitives, we have a tendency to want to deconstruct everything. Why am I showing up the way that I'm showing up? Why am I behaving the way I'm behaving? Deconstruct, deconstruct. Here's my story. Here's my narrative. Here's the thing that's going on, you know, like, from, here's my inner wounding. Here's my childhood trauma. Here's my blah, 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 right? And sometimes it's really valuable to deconstruct all of that, to find the etymology and to do a good, accurate diagnostic of what's going on. And oftentimes the prescription is just go do it anyway. You know what I mean? Like sometimes that's just the prescription. The prescription is, it kind of doesn't matter what all the stories are. Just go do it. for me personally, when I'm in the suds and I'm depressed, I can figure out all sorts of nodes in the system where depression is the emergent. And oftentimes the best thing for me to do to get out of it personally, and I have depression in my family, it runs in my family. My mom has had depression for decades and my brother's dealt with depression. And so it's like one of those things where I just kind of felt like it just wasn't as, and you just have to live with it. And when I started acting as opposed to trying to solve it directly, when I just got into action, that's one of the reasons why I've actually worked out most of my life since I was eight. I joined my first gym at 18. And one of the reasons why I have prioritized in the past working out, but didn't in my 30s, there was like a decade there that was missing. And I think I felt it, even if I didn't recognize what it was. But one of the reasons why I always worked out is because it just made me feel better. Like, my depression got better when I was working out. And now that I'm combining that with eating right, it's like I'm going through some pretty stressful times. There's a lot of stuff on our plates right now. Not necessarily like big horrible things within me, but people we love are in a really bad time period in their life. You and I have a space in our relationship where we're talking about, you know, some things that are kind of, like we're in a power struggle, actually, for the first time in a long time. And so you and I are having a lot of conversations, very like open, transparent, painful, emotional conversations. And, you know, there's like my stepsons, your kids are going through a hard time. Like, there's a lot on our plate. And when I just go work out every day, it's so much more manageable. Because I don't have to, like you said, I don't have to overcomplicate it. I don't have to deconstruct everything. I just go, I get in my body, I honor it, I work out, I get a bunch of oxygen flowing through me, I drink more water because of it, I'm drinking a ton more water. I don't want to eat crappy food because I don't want to undo everything I've just done. I'm trying to get enough sleep because I know that weight loss and muscle build happens in sleep. So it becomes this ecosystem of behaving and taking care of my body. And at the end of all of that, I feel infinitely better.
It grounds you, right? Like, you feel grounded when you do those things.
Yeah. Like, okay, so today, tonight, we have promised the kid that we're going to take him to a local fireman's carnival. I cannot think of anything that sounds more awful to me than going to a local carnival. And we're going to stay until the fireworks, and the fireworks aren't going to happen until 11 p.m. And I'm just like, how do I get out of this?
You gotta be an extroverted sensing sensation, present to the moment, Etodia.
I know. I have to the whole
evening.
You
gotta get present.
And I looked at you and I went, you know what? I gotta go work out. If I'm going to survive the evening, I've gotta go work out. And what's gonna happen is I'm going to get into my body. I'm talking about sensation as if I have it. And I'm actually right now, I realized in this podcast, is I'm advocating for it because I realized how many gifts it's given to me. So I just wanna keep iterating all the things I have personally gotten from other people who use this function, like very positively influencing me. And I realized that in order to survive this evening, which is entirely a sensation experience, being present, being with the kids, experiencing carnival rides, fireworks, you know, like none of this is complex, abstract conversation around a glass of wine, which is like my idea of a good time. It's kind of almost the opposite. And and if I can get to the gym beforehand, I know I'll get in my body, I'll be grounded, I'll get present, and then I can take that with me through the carnival and I'll have a much better time. But if I can't go do that, I know I'm going to have a hard time getting present and it's going to be miserable for me. So the gift that sensation gives me is to remember to have fun, to play. It doesn't all have to be this abstract, deep, complex deconstruction, blah, 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 blah. Like, I can actually be in the moment and go, hey, this is kind of cool and fun, and look at how much Piper is enjoying that ride. Yeah, let's go do it again. And just be with the family and be present and just have an uncomplicated 5 hours where being there is the point. And I think that that's another gift that sensation really gives us.
You know, often sensors, when they get around, maybe you and me, we'll be hanging out with a sensor. And often it's an extroverted sensing person that says this. So this is a sensation person. You and I will maybe be around them, maybe with a couple other, maybe another intuitive or something. We'll start getting in that whole like intuitive fever dream of just like, you know, just going off on these crazy abstract like what if conversations. And so many times, like, extroverted sensing sensational users will say to us, and this really sticks out to me, is, can you guys just relax for a minute? Like, just chill out. Like, and I'm like, we're not tense. We're not unrelaxed. But I think what they're saying is just be present for a moment. Like, you don't have to be, I don't think they're actually trying to get us to chill out, relax, like we've been running hard. It's more like, can you just be present to what's happening? Do you have to abstract everything? Do you have, like, and sometimes it's like annoying because I want to abstract everything. That's just how I'm wired. But it reminds me to go, you know, they actually have a point here. Like, it doesn't always have to be so heavy all the time. It can be, like you said, there's a fun element. There's a playful, fun in the moment element that I think all of us need more of in life. And I'm not saying the synthetic version of it, you know, like even like the amusement park kind of concept or whatever. There's a lot of extroverted sensing sensation happens there, but just in the moments of life, just going out, like last night, my middle son Sawyer wanted to go out on the back porch and he lit some like tiki torches out there. Cause we have these like little tiki torches around the back porch and some citronella candles and the stars are out and the fireflies were out. It was beautiful. And I was like, oh, I got to go get this email checked and do this stuff. And you got to get to bed, man. Cause it was starting to get late. And I'm just like, you know what? I'm just going to take a moment and be out here with him in the moment, almost like an extroverted sensing moment for me, a sensation moment. There doesn't have to be a narrative. We don't have to do anything. We don't have to strive. We don't have to have an abstract conversation. I don't have to teach him lessons of life. I can just come out. We can sit down. We can just both look at the stars together, chat a little bit about whatever's going on. I asked him a little bit about his day. And then we blew up the tiki torches, went in, he went to bed. And I was reminded, like, I can just stop and be present to something, have fun in the moment. That is so powerful. That lesson, especially for me. If you're an intuitive listening, you probably need this message as well, because we tend to be so abstract. It's good to slow down and just get into that fun space. Be there. Be present with your kid, with your spouse, with your lover, with your friends. Just be there and enjoy that moment and be in that experience. It can be such a wonderful, wonderful thing.
I think that the world needs people who think in complicated ways to help solve complicated problems and create complicated systems to solve those problems. And we need people to remind us when we're overcomplicating things, because not everything is a complex problem with a complex solution, and not everything is a simple problem with a simple solution. And we right now, because we're in such a complex time period of history, we have a tendency to forget that some solutions are simple. And sensation reminds us to not overcomplicate things that don't need to be complicated. And that's hard to do, because right now I think we're in a time period where when we want things to be simple, we turn them into sound bites. That's not the message of extroverted sensing or sensation. That's a trick, right? Like, to turn something into a sound bite is not uncomplicating it. It's changing its nature in order to manipulate the person, like clickbait titles. That's not the message of sensation. What the message of sensation is that sometimes the answer is looking us in the face. Sometimes it's really obvious, and sometimes we have to build like you have a book that's really interesting. It's called The Speed of Trust. And I kind of want to, I haven't read it yet. You kind of shared some of the principles and concepts, and I'd like to read it and then maybe talk about it on the podcast. Because the concept of the speed of trust is that once you have trust between two people, there's a lot of energy or resource that you now can recoup to apply to problem solving or to getting into action. And we're in a time period that's very distrustful, right? We don't trust each other. And so because of that, all of this energy gets lost in just trying to negotiate trust built with each other. And if you notice sensation or extroverted sensing at its best, I think of the cooperation that firefighters have when they're trying to put out a fire, right? There's a speed of trust there. Everybody knows their role, everybody knows their position, and everybody knows what they're all trying to accomplish. It's all very clear.
And who they're trying to protect.
Who they're trying to protect, what their mission is, what's going on. And that, I mean, it's astonishing how quick we are at putting out fires. Like, it's kind of incredible. You know, like, when you think about how, like, fires in the past basically meant horrific damage for an entire city.
Yeah, burn the entire city of Chicago to the ground.
Yeah, because the cow, like, knocked something over, right? But now we're so good at putting out fires, in part because we created extroverted thinking systems, right? The fire hydrant there is part of why we're able to do what we're doing. But the other piece of it is it doesn't matter if a fire hydrant is right there ready to, you know, put fires out if there's nobody taking action to facilitate it. And I think sensation is it has an intuitive understanding that if we complicate things too much, we lose the speed of trust. Like if we throw too many variables in there, if we try to make things too complicated, now we're just spending time parsing out, well, this is what I think. Oh, no, this is what I think. Oh, no, now we have to create all these distinctions. And I'm one of those people. I'm an ENTP. I'm a distinction maker. Like my favorite thing to do on the planet is sit down and deconstruct something. Like it literally gives me joy to deconstruct a problem. Like I can't think of anything more than to flay out all the distinctions of a system. And when people's feelings get involved in all of that, now all those distinctions, now like not even asking the simple question of do we agree with each other's premises, not asking simple questions around that, we lose the speed of trust and we just sit there constantly trying to solve problems that we can't even tap into because nobody's hitting the fire hydrant, right? Like nobody's even noticing that right there is a way to solve this problem. And I think the message that sensation can give us is to remember that some things are simple and some things require the speed of trust. And it doesn't have to be that complex to get coordinated together to make something happen. And I really appreciate that because right now I think that we are overcomplicating almost everything. We live in such a complex world that we have taken that for granted. We have taken for granted that everything, it has to be complex, but it doesn't. A lot of things can be simple. And they can be actionable and we can just be simply implementing. So yeah, I think that living in this voyeuristic time period where we passively allow other people to do our living for us, combined by a tendency to want to lean back and deconstruct everything and overcomplicate them, sensation gives us such powerful messages to not lean back but lean in, to get to work, to get into action, to make it happen, to be present, to not complicate things, to lean on each other and just make it happen. And I think that we're sorely missing those messages.
That was beautifully said. I actually have nothing else to add to that. I think that was an elegant way to wrap up some of the ways that extroverted sensing sensation is needed. So we need you now. You've been listening to come over, take some immediate action, get into action. Don't be a voyeur. Just come over and leave a comment, ask a question, or share your story directly below this podcast. Tell us what your experience with extroverted sensing sensation has been. Is it something you use as a strength? Is it more of a challenge for you? Something that's not in your personality and it's hard to get your head around? But we'd love to hear from you. What is your experience in this? What have you seen come up in your life? And where do you think we could advocate for this more as people? What would your advocacy be for extroverted sensing or sensation?
I'm sorry, I have one more thing to say.
Oh, okay. I thought that was a beautiful wrap-up.
Okay, thank you. I appreciate that.
But you did this whole, like, the way your energy was going, it's like landing the plane elegantly, like wrapping it all up with a bow. I'm like, oh, that's perfect. This is going to be a great transition into the next part. It's going to be so elegant.
I'm sorry.
It's good.
I just have one more thing to say. And it's actually to be consistent with the other podcasts. With all the other podcasts, we talked about the need to integrate the polarity opposite.
Yeah.
And we did talk about how sensation reminds us, or extroverted sensing reminds us, that it doesn't always have to have this deep, complex meaning. And also, the best extroverted sensing integrates its polarity opposite of introverted intuition or perspectives. So the best sensation remembers there's consequences to every action. The best sensation remembers that there has to be a meaning applied to it. And so when we have action orientation and not overcomplicating things and being present and remembering to be fun, all those things combined with an understanding and realization that how we live now and the things that we do now and get into action now are gifts to our future self, and also they do have meaning, and that there is something that we're doing these things for, that's when it is a true gift to all of the world.
How I think about it is when you take extroverted sensing action, sensation action, you do something, always remember that every action is creating meaning when you do it. Like you're creating meaning as you go. And you might want to be mindful, especially if this is your process, what meaning am I creating in doing these things? Because again, everything's so immediate and obvious in the moment. And yet there are perceptions or ramifications for everything we do as people. And so I think you're right, seasoning it with that to just say, what meaning am I creating from these actions is a question, especially if you're an SP using this process. That's a really powerful question to ask yourself.
Yeah, and how will it land with others?
Mm-hmm.
Like, am I giving the right message?
Which extrovert sensing kind of has a sense of, like reading body language, reading how people respond to things, watching facial expressions, watching some emotional expression or thought processes in the moment. That's something that extrovert sensing can also be a gift of for you as you ask, how's this going to land with somebody? The meaning that comes with this, the seasoning of the meaning that I'm making with mm-hmm. this action.
Yep. Okay.
So now I can ask what you think.
Yeah. Okay.
Come over to personalityhacker.com, leave a question, ask a comment, or actually the opposite, strike that, reverse that. Ask a question, leave a comment. See, when I say it twice, I always screw it up. Or share your story. That's really the important thing is if you have a story to share about your experience, that's what is really powerful for people to tap into the narratives of life. The experiential stories we all have are so powerful in our world because it helps people get a sense of how this shows up for each other. So come over to personalityhacker.com and do that right below this podcast. You can also join us on social media all over the internet, Instagrams, Twitters, Facebooks, YouTubes, whatever else we're on. But just go find us those places. Follow, like, and be a part of those communities because we're going to continue furthering these discussions between podcasts on social media channels and platforms. So we'd love to have you be a part of those discussions going forward.
Yep. And if you enjoyed this podcast, you can subscribe to us on iTunes, various Android platforms, Spotify, all sorts of places. You can leave us a rating and review on iTunes. That helps us out a lot. We have a book that we wrote. It's called Personality Hacker. If you follow us on the podcast, you know that you have to have 11 copies for the zombie apocalypse. So go get yourself 11 copies of the book and leave us a rating review on Amazon or Goodreads. Or wherever you want to leave us a rating.
These are like, I think it was the last episode. I said, these are like to-do lists now that you have when you listen to the podcast. We just give you like 16 things to do. Go do this, go do that, go do this.
Yeah.
These are opportunities to get into your extroverted sensing process and get into action.
Yeah. Like you said, Joel, don't be a voyeur. Go do something, right?
Right, yeah.
And remember, we recorded this podcast. Like, basically, it was very dangerous to do this because I could have spontaneously combusted at any time. So,
it's true.
Like, this was a very dangerous thing for us to do. But as it turns out, I simply got very, very moist.
So, I'm sure you did. Yeah. And it's very hot. So we're going to end this and then go see if we can seek out air conditioning somewhere.
And demoistify ourselves.
There you go. Thanks for being with us today. My name is Joel Mark Witt.
And I'm Antonia Dodge.
And we'll talk with you on the next Personality Hacker Podcast.